prepare our hearts for worship. People walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressors. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment robed in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Now I invite you to stand for our call to worship. Advent is coming to a close. Prepare the way of the Lord. Be the voice that cries out in the wilderness. Go forth to share the love of God.
For unto us is born in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.
Thank you. the baby Jesus, and we're going to talk about, and your baby brothers, that's right, that was very special. So, I'm going to show you something. Do you see what this is? Do you see what that is? See it? What do we call that? That's right, it's the nativity scene, and this is where baby Jesus is supposed to be. But do you see that something's missing? Yeah, baby Jesus isn't in the manger yet. So I want us to think about Mary and Joseph. Were they parents before they had Joseph? I mean, Jesus? You have a Joseph in your class? Yeah. So Mary and Joseph were parents, right? They were expecting this baby. And so do you think they were nervous? Maybe a little bit, because they've never had a baby before. And so they were nervous and they were maybe a little scared. But guess what? That's right, you've got two new baby brothers. Yeah. So let's look, here's baby Jesus, and we're going to put him in the manger. And do you think once baby Jesus came, Mary and Joseph felt good? Yeah. So sometimes when we have siblings or we have new cousins and we're getting ready for them, we get a little nervous. But guess what? When they get here, is it like they've always been a part of your family? Is it? Well, sometimes. But they're such a wonderful part of your family, right? Yeah. And so you love them, and you can't imagine life without that new sibling, right? And so that's what I want us to think about, that Jesus, when Jesus came, that he opened the family. And it's like he was there and he loves us. And Jesus means Emmanuel, God with us. And so that love that we have for Jesus and that Jesus has for us exists always. Yes, yes. So we have to share that love with others. Okay? Will you pray with me? We'll do an echo prayer. Loving God, thank you for Jesus. And thank you for the love that Jesus has for us. Amen.
Now, Jeff and Emily Graham will light our Advent wreath.
On the first Sunday of Advent, we came together to light the candle of love. On the second Sunday of Advent, we lit the candle of joy. On the third Sunday of Advent, we lit the candle of peace. Today, the fourth Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of hope. In chapter 3 of his book of prophecy, Zephaniah tells us, "Rejoice and exult with all your heart. The Lord your God is in your midst. He will rejoice over with you with your gladness. He will renew you in his love."
God came to be in our midst physically through his Son, Jesus, whose birth we celebrate on Christmas Day. Jesus lived among us to be the promise of God's love fulfilled in human form. God's perfect love is found in Jesus.
God's love is patient and kind. God's love is not quick to take offense. It keeps no records of wrongs and does not gloat over people's troubles, but rejoices in the light, the good, and the true. There is nothing that this love cannot face and no limit to its faith, to its hope, to its endurance. God's love never ends.
As we near the completion of our walk through this Advent season together, let the light and warmth of the love candle inspire you to look ahead, confident in God's promise of love that renews us, makes us whole, and restores us to health and abundant life. Rejoice, beloved, for nothing can separate us from the love of God.
I'm reading from the book of Job, chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes, I and not another. How my heart yearns within me. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's good to see you on this fourth Sunday of Advent. I do want to make an invitation to you. Just in a couple of short days here, we will gather together again and usher in the Advent, the birth of our Lord, together. And I want to make sure you know you're invited. At 4:15, we'll have a children and family service in the chapel. It's a great service. You don't have to worry about whether your kids are being quiet because everybody's going to be loud and noisy over there. And it's a great time. And then at 5 and 11, I'll be honest, I don't care if your kids are in here and are noisy. I want to have them here. I want everybody to be here to celebrate together. And I just think kids add to the excitement of it. So at 5 and 11, candlelight and communion. And I want to make sure you're invited. I also want to remind you, this is a great opportunity that you have to help somebody else, a neighbor, a friend, a colleague, to be able to understand the good news of Jesus by just simply saying, hey, won't you come with me, 5 o'clock or 11 o'clock, to First United Methodist Church and celebrate with us. And we'd love to have you come. So I hope that you will look around for people who may be looking for something this Christmas Eve and invite them to come and join you and be here on Christmas Eve. As we finish off the season of Advent on this fourth Sunday of Advent, I do want to talk about an oft-overlooked theme. You know, we talk about hope and joy and love and peace this time of year, and those are things that are important, don't get me wrong, important themes of the season leading up to Christmas, but there is an overlooked theme that I think is extremely important, something that is something we need to be talking about and mindful. It is one of the most important messages of why Christmas needed to happen, and that is the theme of sin. But you understand why we don't talk about it, right, this time of year? I mean, who would want to light the Advent wreath? I can't imagine the Grahams wanting to come up here and say, I light the sin candle, acknowledging that I'm a sinner, right? But this is what we know. We know that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, the skies and the sea, everything that's in it, populated all of those things, created human beings in God's own image, breathed into us the breath of life, put us in the garden and gave us authority over all things and said, I want you to be a good steward over it. But in the midst of this, God set into place from the very beginning something important. God never wanted us to be robots controlled from a far off distance remotely. God wanted us to have free will, to have the ability to choose. And with that comes the ability to choose to be in relationship with God or not to choose wisely and listen to God or to choose poorly. And so God said, you can eat of anything, but don't eat of the one tree, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Offering us a choice from the very beginning, free will. And we know the serpent used that and tempted Adam and Eve, and eventually they ate from the one tree that they shouldn't have, and there were consequences for that, and original sin entered the world. And from that moment until this moment, every human being that's ever lived on this earth, sans one, has struggled with those same temptations, has made good choices and bad choices, has had to be obedient to God at times and has rebelled against God at times. And you and I are not exempt from that. From understanding that at times in our lives, we have made poor choices that have carried with them consequences. And we know that in our lives or in the lives of people we love or know or hear about or read about, sometimes the consequences of our poor choices can carry with them things that last a long time, if not forever. Some of you know, I've shared before, that in my adult life I've spent a lot of time in prison. with a prison ministry, Kairos. Shame on some of you. And in those opportunities, I sat with young men and adult men, and for them, they've talked about the poor choices they've made and are living out the consequences of those poor choices. Many whom I've had the opportunity to sit across the table from or in a cell with will be in that facility for the rest of their lives with no chance for them ever to be paroled because of a poor choice and the consequence that choice carried for them. And one of the things that's obvious if you spend any amount of time in a place like that is it can lead to a sense of hopelessness. Why does it even matter? I'm never going to get out of here. This morning in our scripture, Bucky read from a man named Job. There's a book in the Bible by that name. Talking about a season of Job's life. We don't know a whole lot about him, except what's written in that book. And really, that's just just a small little piece of his life. What we do know is that he was a righteous man, a God-fearing man, someone who tried to follow God imperfectly, but still tried. And in the season that we get to know Job, we know that he had a lot of family, a lot of wealth, a lot of assets, and he lost it all. He lost all of his wealth, all of his family died, and even lost his health. And in the midst of that, we hear that his friends sort of turn their back on Job. They start talking about him behind his back, and they even go to him and they say, "Job, God, I don't know what you've done, but you need to repent. God is punishing you, obviously, for something, so you need to stop doing it and ask God to forgive you and turn and do something different, because this is awful what's happening to you." And that was a prevailing thought then. Just as it is now, that when something bad happens to us, that it's God's punishment on us, and we start evaluating what it is that we've done to deserve that, right? I'm sure there's more than one of us in this room today who have prayed that prayer of desperation to God, "If you will only restore this situation, heal this person, make this right, then I will stop whatever it is I'm doing," equating our sinful behavior to what's happening as God's punishment on us for it. And Job doesn't necessarily discount all of that. As we read it, he says, "You know, I'm not perfect." He recognizes that he has failed, that he's sinned and fallen short, as have everyone who's walked on this earth. But he doesn't, one, think that he's done anything to deserve that, and two, doesn't think that's who God's nature is anyway. But he can't figure out something that oftentimes is just not able to be figured out. He doesn't understand why all of this is happening. But in the midst of it, Job responds to his friends with a statement of truth that I want us to hear on this final Sunday of Advent. He says to them, leading up to it, I don't know what's going on. I don't know why this is happening to me. I'm losing hope every day. But here's what I know. I know that my Redeemer lives. And one day he will set foot on this earth. He will stand on this earth. And he will stand for me. He will be with me. There's no way that Job could have fully understood the impact of what he was saying. But he was pointing us towards Christmas. He was pointing us toward Jesus. And he was recognizing the fact that one day God would come to earth, would put his feet on this earth, and would stand with us and redeem us. Now, I looked up what does it mean to redeem something. There's a couple of definitions that I think are relevant. The first definition of to redeem means to compensate for something's faults or shortcomings. And the example that it gives in what I was reading says, for example, if you have a bad dinner, you might try to redeem the night by going out for dessert. I thought that's a pretty good way to redeem the night. I'm all for that. The second definition, it says to take repossession of something that has been lost, abandoned, or destroyed. And I immediately started thinking about something that I'm interested in, involved in. Some of you know, along with Dave Stout and Richard Stout, I enjoy hunting cast iron. I don't like new stuff, and I really don't even like stuff that's in excellent shape or in good condition. I like finding pieces of cast iron that are rusty, that are grimy, that are greasy, that just have layer upon layer. I mean, like an inch of grime and junk built up on it from decades of use. Oftentimes these pieces have been mistreated, they've been left outside, they've been not taken care of well, and people are to the point on that of just saying, this is just not good, and we're just going to throw it out and abandon it. It's destroyed, it's seen its best day, it's not useful anymore. And I love finding those pieces, and I'll offer people a few dollars for it, and even then they're going, I don't even know why you want it. And we'll take it back, and with time and a little knowledge of how to restore it, because you can't destroy cast iron unless it cracks, and a whole lot of sweat equity, we can redeem these pieces of cast iron, restore them to their original state, brand new, and put them back to use for what they were supposed to be, what they were created to be used for. And between the three of us, and there may be others in the church, but the three of us talk a lot and work together a lot on cleaning these pieces, we have redeemed countless numbers of pieces of cast iron and put them back for what they were designed to do. No matter how much they've been abandoned or abused or tried to destroy them. And that's what Job is trying to say, that regardless of why he stands in the place he is, he believes that there is one who can redeem him, who can make up and compensate for his shortcomings and for his faults, one who can reclaim him and take back possession of him, even though he feels like he's been abandoned and destroyed and has no hope. And that's a powerful message of Christmas, of why we celebrate this day and hold it at such high regards. That Christmas came. Jesus came and stepped on this earth to redeem those of us with the past. And let me let you in on a little secret. That's you. And you. And most especially me. That no matter what your past holds, that no matter how much fear you have that one day the skeletons in your closet will come out and you'll suffer the humiliation of your past, God's not abandoned you. God's not given up on you. In fact, at just the right time, he sent the one to redeem you, to compensate for your faults and mine, to take possession back of you that had been abandoned and lost or destroyed by life and by the brokenness of this world, and to take us back to what we were intended to do and give us our purpose back. To put to bed the things of our past and allow us to wake up to a new and glorious morn. I want to end the season of Advent by showing you a video. It's one that's very emotional for me, and I hope it is for you. But I want to explain to you, this is a video that we would show when we would go into the prisons at some point over the Kairos weekends to the men that we were ministering with and just share with them. The video comes from Marion Correctional Facility in Marion, Ohio, the state penitentiary there. And this had a reputation at one point of being one of the worst in the entire nation. Most of the people there were lifers, had done violent crimes. And these people had no hope. And when you have no hope, then you really don't care what the costs or repercussions are. And they were violent there in the prison, and they were having a lot of problems trying to control this prison and the men who were in it. And in the midst of that, one of the things that they did that turned out to change the whole game was they sent in a new warden. Her name was Dr. Christine Money. And with her, Dr. Money brought Jesus. She decided she was going to love on those men there, treat them with respect. She was going to teach them about the gospel and how God hadn't given up on them. She created optional faith-based programs that they could opt into to do, and many of them took advantage of that. And one of the programs that she started, that she led herself, was a silent choir, she called it. And basically it was a choir in which she would teach them sign language, and they would sign the words to the songs as an act of worship, as an act of ministry. And they would lead worship there at the facility, and they would record these things and send them out to others to be able to use. And on special occasions, they would even go out to share that message with others, a level of freedom that none had ever experienced there. When you watch this, I want you to know that most of these men will never, ever see the light of day outside of that facility. Most of them have been sentenced to life without parole, or worse. Most of them should be hopeless. But I want you to look on the expressions of their face, look at their hearts through this, and see if they look like a person without hope to you. The song is called My Redeemer Lives. It's based on the scripture we read today from the book of Job. Take a look at this.
I'm
Christmas came to not only come and stand on this earth, but to stand with you and me, to be on our side, to redeem our pasts, and offer us hope for a future, to take back what we were created to do, our purpose in life, and give us a new and glorious morning. Don't forget to celebrate that on Wednesday morning. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our song of response will be on page 211. It'll be on the screen as well. I invite you to stand as you're able and sing with me, O come, Emmanuel.
These are our prayer concerns this morning. The Hamblin family, the Cotton family, Dee Butterball, unspoken prayers, travelers during the holidays, those with health issues, Mark Jagger, Eddie Pulowski, the death of his sister, praise for our wonderful church, praise for our beautiful sanctuary, Elizabeth Mulder, Pat and Glenda Phillips, Jerry Nicosia, Bill Mason in the hospital, the Hart family and the death of Tammy this week. Their home was destroyed by a tornado while she was in the hospital. Kamari Orange family and the loss of his dad. Prayers for Bob Cowan family, for the Bob Cowan family whose funeral is today. Stan Baker, Dee Butterball, Trisha Hughes. Prayers for safe travel, harmony in families. For those who feel that Christmas is like any other day. Praise for this amazing church, staff, and members who try to bring Christmas to our community daily. Thanks be to God for his Son, Jesus Christ. Prayers for Bobby Gwynn, Reed Fleming, Donna Buckingham, and children. Dee Butterball. Those families with loss of loved ones this Christmas season. Anita Kimbrough, recovery from a heart attack. Dee Butterball. Ms. Barbara, Ms. Marie, Paul Timms, our troops. Greta Gallagher, Cassie Hayes, and family. The Ricky Thorne family, Joey Eastus, our military. Praise for the birth of our healthy baby boys, Logan Wayne and Parker Samuel. Continue prayers for Mom, Tara, as she recovers from preeclampsia. Prayers for Mary Butler, Wayne Rogers, all those that have lost loved ones. Pray that we keep the true meaning of Christmas in our hearts. Comfort for the Swain family, Lynn Moss, Steve and Stacy Leisure, Martha Grigsby. The family of Ruby Melton, family of Johnny Robbins, the family of Gary Nesbitt, Ivory Hooper, Don Mitchell, the family of Joyce Reed, the family of Dustin Salter, Mark Callender, Beverly Chadwick, Becky Bennett. Praise for my mother's good health this Christmas. Prayers for my niece's strength and healing from cancer. I hope you'll remember these folks as we come to our prayer time this morning. This morning you may pray where you are.
Thank you.
one who compensates for our faults lives. The one who has come to take back possession of those that have been lost, abandoned, or destroyed, he walks on this earth. He's come to be with you, to stand with you. He's on your side. Let us celebrate this Christmas. Go in peace.